for your contribution to the meeting tonight. Very much appreciated, and of course, the message of the gospel contained in every single message in song that we heard this evening. So thank you very much for your help, and may the Lord continue to bless you and use you in the service of the Master, not only today, but in the days to come in his will. I think this morning I omitted to say I was glad to be here. So I better do it now. I'm glad to be here to again renew some fellowship with you and to have the opportunity of ministering in your meeting this morning, and then of gathering around the table with the Lord's people to remember the Savior in his own appointed way, and then to be back tonight for the gospel meeting. It's been a pleasure to me to come, and I want to thank the fellowship very much for the invitation and the opportunity to be with you again for another day in the service of the Lord. I want to say a particular word of thanks to our two good friends, Mr. and Mrs. Campbell down there, for their hospitality and fellowship that was enjoyed greatly today. I certainly did appreciate the welcome to their home and to the time that we enjoyed together, and I thank them very, very much for that in the Lord's name. I don't know if you've ever gone to their home for dinner or not, but I can assure you it's a worthwhile experience. Why don't you all go next Sunday and see what happens? Please don't, or I'll never be asked back. But I think you know what I mean. It was good, and I thank them very sincerely for their kindness toward me today. Now, will you come with me again in your Bible, please, to the book of Titus, and back to the chapter and to the very same passage as we were considering together in the meeting this morning. And I want just to continue on as we seek to bring the message of the gospel to you in the meeting this evening, continuing on this theme of the grace of God. I mentioned to you that I'd elaborate just a little before I read tonight on the distinction and difference between grace and mercy. I went as far as to tell you that grace is the act of God whereby he bestows upon me all that I never deserved as a sinner. And mercy is the act of God whereby he takes away from me all that I ever deserved. Sorry, grace gives me what I never deserved, and mercy removes all that I ever deserved. Now, if you're in the meeting tonight, a non-Christian, not saved, not converted, we're glad you're here. But do listen until I explain to you a little about what that means. Because in mercy, God has taken Satan out of my life. And in grace, he has given me God. Now, isn't that amazing? Because the scripture teaches that if a person is saved and genuinely born again, they have been brought from the power of Satan unto God. Now, mercy pushed the devil out, and grace brought Christ in. That's wonderful. But more than that, we have been brought, mercy has taken hell out of my future. The torment and the flames mine eyes shall never see. And we have been brought into a position where grace has given me heaven. Now you see the two working again. Hell is gone for all eternity, and heaven has come for all eternity. When these two things work together in an experience of an individual, they are marvelous. And then, of course, you could go on to say this, that mercy has taken wrath out of my future. There's a day coming, I read in the Bible, when the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? But those who know the Savior have no appointment with wrath. None at all. Jesus is coming, and instead of wrath, praise God, in grace, we're going to have glory. Because the Lord Jesus prayed, Father, I will, that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. And someday, the true believer is going on a conducted tour of heaven, and the one who will take us round will be our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, I could go on comparing and contrasting the two, but I think you can see the distinction between mercy and grace. And of course, as we pointed out to you this morning, I point out to you again tonight, peace is the result. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now let's come to this chapter, because in verse number 11, we have what grace brought. You remember, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. Now we elaborated on that this morning, and I won't take it any further just now. Secondly, in the next verse, verse 12, you have what grace taught, teaching us that denying, or if you like, denouncing two negatives on godliness and worldly lust, then there are three positives. We should live soberly, righteously, godly in this present world. That term, present world, is most interesting, because the world passeth away and the lust thereof, but him that doeth the will of God abideth forever. So if you're with us again tonight, a non-Christian, and you want to abide in forever under the shadow of good, then make sure that you get to know the Savior. That's the only way that you can escape the wrath and the judgment of God. Now, when you come into the next verse, you have what grace wrought, or placed, if you like, within the heart of the believer. And here it is. It's a tremendous statement. Paul, writing again, said this, looking for that blessed hope. Now, let me take a little bit of time to elaborate on that one this evening. You see, friends, as we go through this world, those of us who know the Savior, avoiding ungodliness and worldly lust, yes, living soberly and righteously and godly to the best of a God-given ability, our eyes are toward the skies, and we're looking constantly, continually, day in and day out for Christ to keep his promise. That promise is referred to here as the blessed hope, the fact that Jesus is coming again. I remember many, many years ago now, friends, conducting a gospel mission in a district a long way from here. And during one of the meetings, when I was bringing the message of the gospel, I heard a kind of a thud or a crash down at the back of the hall. And when I looked, I saw two or three people running toward a man, and the man had taken a very serious stroke, and he fell off the seat. Now, we had to hold back the meeting for a short time until we finally got help for him and got the man removed from the gathering. He was taken home. He was an old man, away in his late 80s. And during the course of that mission, I was to learn something through that event that sticks to me to this day. I promised him that while the mission continued, and when God gave me the strength to do so, I would go down every single morning and visit him, and I did. I went down every morning, and I found him still in bed in his own bedroom. Now, you remember the old blackout window blinds there used to be. Some of you young people would hardly remember those, but a whole lot of you in the meeting tonight would. And they were put on, you see, so that the planes coming over to bomb Belfast wouldn't find any directions or anything of the kind, blacked everything out. And they were still in the windows of this house. And when I went in to see that old man lying in the bed, every morning he did the same thing. He reached over and he grabbed this tassel thing that was hanging at the end of the window blind, and he always let it up with a rip. I can hear it going yet. And he would look at me and he would say, as the light came in, "I wonder, will he come today?" What a lesson to learn. What instruction for a younger man in those days, going out attempting to preach the gospel and to win the lost for the Savior. "I wonder, will he come today?" What saddens me is this. I don't hear it so much as I used to. The fact of the Lord's return seems to have become obscure. I talked to a man one day recently, and he told me this. He says, "I don't bother about it too much. It will pan out some way." I said, "Friend, the next event on God's prophetic program, and you're telling me that it's going to pan out some way. If I go, listen, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." What a promise is this. What a blessed hope. The hymn writer said, "O joy, O delight, should we go without dying? No sickness, no sadness, no dread and no crying, caught up through the clouds with the Lord into glory, when Jesus receives his own. O Lord Jesus, how long? How long ere we shout the glad song? Christ returneth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen." Tell me, child of God, tonight, are your eyes toward the skies? Are you watching and waiting and longing for the Lord's return? Now, let me tell you something. That coming is sure. It's a blessed hope. And it will take place. Sooner or later, he will come. Possibly sooner now. Because as I look out in the world we're living in today, and as I look into this book, I can see the stage being set, not for his coming to the air, but for his coming to the earth, which I'll touch in a moment or two. But before he comes to the earth, he has got to come to the air first to take his people away. Now look, if everything is lined up and is being lined up, even as I talk to you this evening, for his return to the earth in power and great glory, how close are we not to the day when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more? His coming is sure. His coming is swift. I don't know whether you've ever taken time to look at some of the words that are used concerning the second coming of the Lord Jesus. He's coming quickly. How do you explain quickly? He's coming in a moment. How do you explain a moment? He's coming in the twinkling of an eye. One old guy I knew describes that as half a wink. How do you describe half a wink? But the rapidity of his coming is amazing, because the dead in Christ shall rise first. The living shall be changed, and we're going to be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. His coming is sure, and his coming is swift. But let me say this. His coming is separating. Now here's the bit. Two shall be grinding together. One shall be taken, the other left behind. Industrial separation. Two shall be working in the field. One shall be taken, the other left behind. Agricultural separation. Two shall be sleeping together. One shall be taken, the other left behind. Relational separation. The whole of society as we know it will be rent in two. Now the question is, if the Lord Jesus Christ were to come before 8 o'clock tonight, and I can't tell you that he will, but I equally can't tell you that he won't, I wonder who from this service would go, and I wonder who would be left behind. I remember conducting a mission in Rathfrieland many, many years ago now. And it was a mission where God was moving and working. And people were coming to the Savior nightly. And we were praising God for what he was doing. And on the last Sunday night of the mission, I can well remember this, that we were singing the closing hymn. And there was a gentleman sitting right in the corner of the front seat. And he got up from that seat, he walked to the front of the pulpit, and he spoke up to me. And I couldn't make out what he said. We were singing. And then he went straight into the inquiry room. And I said to the pastor, I said, look, you better go in there after that guy and see what's wrong or what's up. And I said, I'll join you as soon as I go to the door. But I didn't get to the door or back into the room, rather, as quick as I thought, because there was another man and his wife wanted to be saved that night, and I had to deal with him. And when I got back into the room, I discovered that the fellow was already saved. The pastor had led him to the Lord, thank God. And as we were about to leave, and we had prayed with him and gave him some literature, I said to him, friend, I want to ask you something. He said, okay. I said, look, when you left your seat tonight and came to the front and told me, spoke up to me, and then darted into the inquiry room, told me what you did. What did you say? He said, I couldn't make you out. He looked at me and he said this. He said, I said to you, I don't want to be the one that's left behind. I said, but you explain that to me. He said, you led a lady to the Lord here last Monday evening in the mission. I said, that's right. He said, that was my wife. And he says, I didn't want to be left if the Lord comes and she goes. I wanted to make sure that we were caught up together. Anyone in that position here tonight? Now, as a comparative stranger tonight, friends, knowing not everybody, just some, I can talk freely. Is there a couple here tonight, David, in two, by the Lord's return? Maybe the husband's saved and you're not. Isn't it time you were? Maybe the wife's saved and you're not. Isn't it time you were? Maybe the parents are saved and the children are not. Isn't it time you were saved too? Maybe the children are saved and the parents are not. It is time to seek the Lord. I ask you, friend, why do you wish to give your relations days and nights of anxiety, knowing that Jesus is coming and you're going to be left behind? I preached on this one night. And after the meeting was over, a man came up to me, and the tears were blinding him. And I knew he was a Christian. And I said to him, friend, what's wrong? Why are you weeping like this? Oh, he said, if only my family were saved. But he said, I'm the only one that is. And it breaks my heart to know that I'm going, and they're going to be left behind. Maybe you've tripped over the feet of people praying for you and you haven't come to the Savior yet. My friend, it's time to seek the Lord. Can I be very personal with you? What spite have you against your soul tonight? You say to me, preacher, I have no spite against my soul, haven't you? Why would you damn it when God will save it? Why? If that's not spite, have you got a better word? Why do you want to drag it to hell when Christ would bring it to heaven? Jesus is coming. And what a separation there will be on that day when the Lord returns. But what a blessed hope for the believer, caught up together to meet the Lord in the air, looking for that blessed hope. As a believer tonight in the meeting, can I just say something to you and then pass on quickly? The things that were written aforetime are written for our learning. Did you ever think of Noah and his ark? This massive floating zoo that Noah constructed and made, and I believe with all my heart in Noah's ark. I really do. It's a fantastic subject. But did you ever notice where the window is? Now, this is interesting. I mentioned this morning to you about the three stages of salvation. Well, Noah's ark was a three-story vessel, which depicts the three stages of God's salvation. Now, the window was not in the back, nor the front, nor the side. The window was in the roof. You know what that's telling me? Noah never saw the flood. He was in the door shop. Now, he saw the effects of it when it was all over. And I meet some people sometimes, and they're going through the tribulation. Well, my friend, the Lord bless you. I'll wave to you on the way up. I'm not waiting to see tribulation. I have no appointment with anything of the sort, according to the Thessalonian epistle. I feel I must be like Noah, and I must keep my eye on the sky and look through the window, because Jesus is coming again. That's the rapture. But let me go on for the sake of time. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing. Now, let me say this to you tonight, that the blessed hope and the glorious appearing are not the same thing. The second coming of the Lord Jesus takes place in two stages. He's coming first to the air to call his waiting people home. That's the rapture of the church. That could happen at any moment. Then there's going to be the great tribulation, whenever Antichrist will appear. All of these terrible things. I haven't heard the news again today, but I've heard people praying in your prayer meeting. And if what they're praying is correct, and I have no doubt it is, then the book is being fulfilled again today before our very eyes. Things to do with the nation of Israel. Someone asked a good friend of mine one time, where was his evidence of God? And he only gave one word as an answer: Israel, the eternal people. And that is the answer. The scene is being set today for the last of the last days. You see, the last days began when our Lord Jesus Christ was born. But we're not in the last days as such. We're in the last of the last days. We're coming to the end of the age. The tribulation will happen, and then at the end of that tribulation, there's going to be this glorious appearing. Now, the term means the appearing in glory, actually. When Jesus will come right down to earth, and when his feet will stand upon the Mount of Olives, and of course, you know the rest of the story. I'm not going into it tonight. And he's going to set up his great kingdom here on earth. And that kingdom will last for 1,000 years, because he must reign until he hath put all enemies under his feet. Now, here's the lovely thing for those of you that are saved. You know, when he comes back, we're coming with him. We're coming back down to the earth again. And when he sets up his kingdom, we're going to have a part in that kingdom. And of course, the part you have and the part I have in that kingdom depends on how faithful you have been to him during your lifetime. That's part of the reward that you will receive at the judgment seat of Christ. But my friends, what a day when Jesus reigns. Read Psalm 2. Why do the heathen rage? Or the people imagine a vain thing. You'd almost think you were reading something out of a morning newspaper. And on the same the psalm goes, but yet, says God, I have set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. Now, Zion's not in heaven. Zion's on earth. And Jesus shall reign where'er the sun. That's the appearing in glory. So just think about it. You're going up with him, child of God, and then you're coming back down with him. You know, I knew a lady very well, still know her. And her daughter came to me one day in great despair. She says to me, Harvey, will you do me a favor? Well, I never like to not do favors for ladies, you see, because if you don't do it, then you could be in trouble. Sorry, ladies, but there's only one thing ever I found in my life was worse than the devil in trousers, and that was a devil in a skirt. That's why I try to keep the right side of you all the time. But she says to me, can I get you to do me a favor? Well, I said, I'll try. She says, I live alone with my mother, and she says, I want to go on a foreign holiday, and she won't go. She won't go up on a plane. Could you convince her? Well, I said, this is some job you're giving me. But she's as thick as champ, this woman. You convince her about nothing. You know. Well, I said, right, I'll have a go. So I went along to the house. I told her straight. I said, your daughter's been talking to me. She wants to go on a holiday and you won't go, and she'll not go without you. She says, I'm not going up on a plane. I said, you're going up someday without one. What? She said. I said, the Lord's coming. I said, do you think he's going to send a jumbo jet or a Concorde or something just for you? I said, you're going up without one. She says, I never thought about that. Never did. Well, do you know what the outcome of that was, friend? I think the girl could see me far enough. She went on the holiday, and now you couldn't keep her out of plane. Every chance she gets, she's away to some foreign part, and the daughter has to tag along now. The whole thing's reversed. We're going up without an assistance of any sort. The magnetism of his coming and the appearing in glory, we're coming back with him. But here's something. I have so much more I'd like to tell you, but the time's almost gone. Who is this person we're talking about? You look at the latter part of that verse. This is amazing. Looking for that blessed hope and the appearing in glory, or the glorious appearing of the great God. You see that? Now, only the Lord God Almighty could do this. There's no one else who could. And you can't go any higher than God. That's as high as you can go. He is God over all, blessed forever, of the great God. And of course, that great God is our God tonight, because we know the Savior. But here's the delightful bit. The great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Who is Jesus Christ? He is the great God. Oh, let's never, never, never let that down, friends, at any stage. Everything God is, Christ is. He is co-equal and co-eternal with the Father. I and my Father are one. I met a Jehovah's Witness on the street in Belfast recently. And we got into a conversation which could very easily have developed into an argument. And I didn't want that out on the street in front of people. I wasn't going to go there. But he tried to tell me that the Lord Jesus Christ was a created being. And I turned him to that verse. I said, friend, read it for yourself. The great God and our Savior. I said, who is the great God? Oh, he says, that's Jehovah. I said, who's our Savior? Jesus Christ. Therefore, I said, Jesus Christ must be Jehovah as well. He had no answer to that. There cannot be one to it, because God and Christ are one. He's Emmanuel, God with us. And I want to tell you this, friends. Those of us who know him, we have never seen as yet his amazing abilities. My, he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can even ask or think. And we'll only see that in reality when he comes again. You ever think about that statement I've just made? Preaching about it here the other night. He's able to do all that we ask or think. Now, if I had written it, that would be probably all I've said. But no, Paul said he's able to do above all that we can ask or think. And even that will not do. He's able to do abundantly above all that we can even ask or think. And even that's not enough. He's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think. What a God. We limit him so much by our unbelief. And my friend, if you're here without the Savior tonight and you need a changed heart and a new life and you need a beginning that will bring you off the broad and crowded way that leads to destruction, and you want to get your feet onto the narrow way that leads to heaven and home, Christ is the answer. And Christ is here tonight. The Master is come, and he calleth for thee. Why don't you yield to him? For now is the accepted time, and now is the day of salvation. I won't preach in the other verse, but I'll tell you what's here, then you can look it for yourself. What grace brought, what it taught, what it wrought, and what it sought is in verse number 14. Remember, we touched it briefly at the Lord's table this morning. Who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity. And that's from the pains of iniquity in eternity and the practice of iniquity in time. Redeem us from all iniquity. And I think this is amusing, really. And purify unto himself a peculiar people. Does that mean the Lord's people are a bunch of oddballs? Well, surely Christ makes a difference. Surely. If there's no change in the life of a person who professes to know Christ, then the whole profession is subject, is suspect. There has to be a change. All is changed when Jesus comes to stay. A peculiar people. A people who are marked out as different. A people that the men and women of the world who see us would like to be. A people whose example is set before the world that they may see in us what Christ can do. I remember when I came to the Savior at first as a teenager, they gave me a fortnight. Well, it's a wee bit longer than that. It's over 50 years ago. And we're here still. Sadly, some of the people who gave me a fortnight haven't got there yet. And I think that's very tragic. Very, very tragic. How are these people marked out? One final thing. Zealous of good works. They have got a zeal for doing good. Well, maybe if someone confessed in prayer, I think it was tonight, maybe here or in the meeting, I'm not sure, that there was a time when we had a zeal for doing evil. But when Jesus comes into your life, you have a zeal for doing good. Well, that's a little more about the grace of God. Can I ask you something just as I finish? You saved tonight. Could you stand up and say, saved by grace alone? This is all my plea. If not, why not? Let me challenge you. I'm not going to do it, but think about it. If I was to start with our brother Willie John here and bring you all up one at a time and ask you to tell us when and where the Lord saved you, could you do it? Or would you stand and blush? No testimony to give. No assurance of heaven or salvation. That can change tonight by coming as a sinner to Jesus. Can we help you? Stay and talk to us, friend. That's why we're here. We'll be around for a little time after the meeting's over. You wait and talk. What a joy it would be to open this book tonight and to further explain to you the way of salvation and to lead you to this great Savior, to see you going through that door, rejoicing in the knowledge of sins forgiven. Thank you for your attention. God bless you, everyone. Now, let's come.